بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول محمد وعلى آله وصحابه معين، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. قل هل يستوي الذين يعلمون والذين لا يعلمون؟ وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: إنما شفاء العي السؤال. So my dear brothers and sisters, inshallah today I'm going to make an introduction of Muqaddimah of Ibn Khaldun rahimahullah ta'ala. Muqaddimah I studied when I was a student in Nahdlatul Ulama, because this is one of the, you know, in the curriculum of Nahdlatul Ulama they have many new additions, you know, compared to all the madrasas in India. So one of the thing, you know, no doubt most madrasas they don't teach history, but Nahdlatul Ulama has, you know, good syllabus for history, and Muqaddimah of Khaldun is one of the important texts that they teach. They don't teach the whole text, but especially his ideas about historiography, you know, history, cultural history, sociology, his ideas about economics, and mostly we learnt his ideas about education. And my intention actually has been to teach that in length, his ideas about education. Because other things, you know, everybody teaches, but people don't make effort to understand what are his ideas about education. But now, you know, Faisal has, you know, asked me to say something about also his ideas about evolution, because there are so many misunderstanding. So that will take time, because the thing is actually what he said about, you know, about you know, development of the, you know, human, you know, can see the creation, nothing to do with evolution. But anyway, people have been misused. So I will inshallah write that his actual actually text, what he has said, and how we have to understand that. Then I realized it's very important to learn that, because people keep using Ibn Khaldun, Jahil, and many Muslim scholars, that they also, you know, had, you know, they believed in the theory of evolution, though actually nothing to do with theory of evolution, it's something different. So you can see yourself, you can read yourself, you can understand what they have been saying. So all this misunderstanding which you actually keep hearing, it can be removed inshallah, though it will take a lot of time, you know, at least, you know, to explain this properly, maybe 1 hour more than that. I'll come to that inshallah as well. but certainly inshallah in the afternoon, if I have enough time, I'll expand on his theory of education, because that is very, very important, and we Muslims are not learning from him. And you know, he wrote all those things, you know, almost 600 years, but still you can see Muslims in education, you know, they are not as advanced as Ibn Khaldun used to be. They are far, far behind than his time. So that is very important. You know, like we can see, you have Al-Azhar in Egypt, you have, centers of education in Tunisia, in Morocco, in India, and Pakistan. Nothing compared to what actually his ideas are. People even don't make effort to understand what Ibn Khaldun has, you know, said. You know, if you can develop further, that's fine. But the thing actually is, we even don't know what they have been doing and how they have been teaching and learning. So inshallah, that I'll present, you know, in a more coherent way, inshallah. Certainly, Muqaddimah is really very important text. Like in Islam, if there have been few works which are important, like you can see Sahih Bukhari or Sahih Muslim or Imam Shafi's Al-Risala, you know, or Imam Shatibi's Al-Muwafaqat, you know, these great works like Waliullah Dehlawi's Hujjatul Al-Baligha. Certainly, Muqaddimah of Ibn Khaldun is one of the greatest works ever have been produced, not only in Islam, but in the history of the mankind. Actually, you know, West, no doubt, you know, studied many texts written by Muslims. But they always, you know, there are many things like Ibn Sina al-Farabi they have been writing, but they are out of date. But still they respect Ibn Sina al-Farabi, but what Ibn Khaldun wrote, it is still relevant. You know, his ideas about sociology, his ideas about economics, his ideas about education, his ideas about philosophy of history, they are so modern, people actually cannot believe. And that's why you can see the Western and East and West both agree to respect this man. Nobody has any doubt about the greatness of this man. Actually, Western people, they benefited from Ibn Khaldun more than Muslims. Muslims don't read him. Most Muslims don't know who Ibn Khaldun is. But people in the West, they have been much more respect for Ibn Khaldun. You know, Al-Maqrizi, who just little after him, a great, you know, Arab historian in Egypt. You know, he writes, what he says, anybody who knows history, when they read Ibn Khaldun, they know what Ibn Khaldun is. So Maqrizi said, "Lam ya'mal ahadun mithalaha." Nobody ever has made anything similar to his Muqaddimah. It never happened. And then he said, "Wa innahu la'azizun an yanala mujtahidun manalaha." And it is really nearly impossible, or maybe very rare, very difficult, that anybody who makes effort to get near to that, to get same thing. So you can see what Makhrizi said. Never has been any work similar to Muqaddama of Ibn Khaldun. And he also said it is very difficult or really nearly impossible that anybody can do what Ibn Khaldun has done. And then, you know, British famous historian, Toynbee, the one who wrote, you know, great book, you know, Fall, Rise and Fall of a Roman Empire, you know, great man. You know, he said very rightly, you know, about Muqaddama, you know, you can see, I've written in the second paragraph where he said about Muqaddama, a philosophy of history, which is undoubtedly the greatest work of its kind that has ever been created by any mind in any time or place. He's not a Muslim. He's not an Arab. You know, he's a British historian, but what he says about Muqaddama is the greatest, you know, say the greatest work of its kind that has ever been created by any mind in any time or in any place. Nothing similar to that. And similarly, you know, the great British philosopher, you know, same, you know, Robert Flint, he so nicely he writes that, you know, nothing equal to that really. He said the other historians, they actually, they never, they are not worthy to be mentioned within Khaldun. So, you know, this, you know, his respect always have been in the mind of the people. Really, if you read the work, you can see, you know, see, he's so much ahead of his time. Nothing suggests that how this person actually can get these ideas other than his thinking and, you know, amazing mind. Because nothing there is to suggest. People who are writing that time and what people are producing in madrasas those time, it is nothing equal to Ibn Khaldun. Amazing mind, amazing thing, you know, how he thinks. And that's why actually he got amazing respect in his time. You always find him near the kings and the rulers and the ministers, always big post, because wherever he goes, everybody respects him. You know, empires, you know, and kingdoms falls and, you know, rise and falls in his time. But whenever the next king comes, he needs Ibn Khaldun. You know, when Taimur Lung, you know, great ruler from Central Asia, you know, when he came to invade, you know, all Muslim world, destroying every single thing. So when he invaded Damascus, that time Ibn Khaldun was in Damascus with somebody before him, other dynasty. And when dynasty fell down, you know, Taimur Lung comes, then they put Ibn Khaldun in the prison. Because they don't know. And then in the night or in the morning, somebody mentioned to Taimur Lung that you know who you have put in the prison? Ibn Khaldun. And then, you know, he is amazed and shocked, and he invites, calls him and listens to his ideas and releases him. You can see a people, enemy or what friend. Nobody can actually, you know, nobody can afford, you know, to not benefit him. Everybody benefits him. Actually, people think really that, you know, Ottoman Empire actually, when established properly, it has got many, many ideas from Muqaddama Ibn Khaldun, how to make empires, you know, solid and keep it lasting. Because his ideas about empires, how to keep it lasting, is amazing, amazing ideas. Some of them, inshallah, I'll mention. But anyway, simple thing is, this man always had respect in his time. Anywhere he goes, in Spain, in Morocco, in Fez, in Egypt, in Damascus, wherever he goes, people respect him. And wherever he goes, he gets post. Either as a minister, or judge, or teacher, whatever. He has been teaching in the main centers of learning, and all the dynasty rulers who come one after the other, they can fall down, but he never falls. He all the time respected by the people. And certainly, he's a man really deserves to be respected. You know, like, one thing, you know, I mentioned, you know, this, I wrote, you know, few pages you have seen actually. One thing is not necessarily that whatever Ibn Khaldun says, everything new. But certainly he has put it in a way more scientific and systematic way. You know, some ideas of his about his, you know, historiography or history or how, you know, of philosophy history, they are not very new. Many things have been, you know, done before that by Muhaddithin and also by the historians who are more muhaddith like Imam Zahabi and other people, they have done. But the only problem has been when muhaddithin applied their ideas of history, they only applied to what they think Islam. Meaning is those hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam which are concerned to the religion. The ahkam, the ruling, the ibadat, basically that was the concern was. They need not make any effort to apply, you know, those ideas, you know, of their of writing history to the Syria literature, for example, to the literature of the conquest, Futuhat, or to the history in general. They did not make effort. That's why Muslim history, though it is still far, far better than any history at that time, any part of the world, because people did not have sense of history better than Muslims any time anyway. But Muslim history, you know, compared to what Ibn Khaldun, the idea is actually not so advanced, you know, in those days. Reason is because they did not make effort to apply those rules and those principles to the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to the conquest to Futuhat, and also to rest of the history of Islam.